Thank you very much, and forgive my voice if it gives up halfway through it. I'll try to do my best Marlon Brando impersonation, and I'll give you a presentation you cannot refuse. So NetScientific, NetScientific was listed in 2013, but a new team came in place in 2020, which took the company in a different direction. And part of that was the acquisition of EMV Capital, which I founded as a specialist deep tech investor. And since then, a number of interesting things have happened. We have completed a turnaround. But in particular, we have built up the portfolio and we have implemented a hands-on proactive investment strategy across a portfolio of 24 companies, which is driving significant value. Briefly, what we do is quite simple. We identify interesting assets, interesting companies in life sciences, sustainability and industrials. We invest in those. We do that in a fairly structured way. We tend to drive value as we make those investments. We then implement a proactive investment strategy, a program of changes. We then, using the EMV Capital subsidiary, we bring third-party investment into those companies. And then we look to exit them or to make some partial or full liquidity events. Now, we have a differentiator, we think, in our space with what we call the capital light investment strategy, which is to say that we don't only use our balance sheet when we make investments. In fact, we use a very tiny part of our balance sheet, and sometimes we don't use the balance sheet at all. That's enabled by the EMV Capital subsidiary, which is able to syndicate investments both from EAS, family office sources, as well as friendships, partnerships with corporate VCs and other VCs. As a result, when you look at our portfolio, it is a mixture of direct equity investments and managed stakes, which gives us a diverse source of investments. And the final thing I'll say is that we like to pay our way through life. We charge the companies for the corporate finance and support services we provide, which again makes NetScientific more independent and more sustainable. Turning to the team, my own background is, as you can tell by my accent, I'm neither from the Highlands or the Lowlands, nor am I from England. I'm Bulgarian by origin, but grew up in Southern Africa, built a business there, came here and sort of stayed behind. But in terms of my background, it's a mixture of focus on IP, building a business in the energy space, in medtech, and it's a fairly multidisciplinary approach that has led me to the model that I've built with my colleagues. Also here is Ed Hooper, another executive director and also general counsel, who was head of capital markets at a prominent city firm before I managed to convince him to join us. But I've been working with him for many years, and that gives us deep in-house capability around transactions, M&A, IPOs, and beyond. We are supported by a NET team. John Clarkson is non-executive chair, ex-PwC. Professor Stephen Smith, who set up Imperial's medical school and founded a company that's now listed on the Tokyo Stock Exchange. And recently, Jonathan Robinson joined us, who's built his own businesses in in the online digital space, but material science background, which is quite useful for us. What's backing us, some similarity to what you do. What's backing us, what's below us or perhaps above us, is a team of about 10 people in fundraising, portfolio operations and management, as well as a group of venture partners and advisors with whom we've worked over many years in different businesses with whom we have a lot of trust. So it's a small but flexible and quite effective team. Now, how do we do what we do? Well, the first thing I mentioned is the proactive management of the portfolio. We are not, absolutely not, a passive investor. Many companies that approach us for money, when they learn about our approach, they prefer to go for passive money, and that is perfectly fine. We tend to get involved where we see we can add value in a specific way. Now, within the broad portfolio, what we've also seen is that, you know, where we really want to get involved is where we have not only a significant stake, but also where we can see, look, here is an episode that if we get deeply involved for a 9 or 12 or an 18-month period, we can help the company move to the next stage and we can see how we can make money out of it. So we've got a cohort approach that I'll talk about in a second. That means that we're focused on a subset of our portfolio at any point in time. We charge fees, as I mentioned, which is quite important in our model and nowadays in the current environment is actually perhaps critical. But also we have flexibility. One of the benefits of doing what we do, not as a fund, but as a PLC, is that we're able to react to opportunities very quickly, and we're very creative in terms of financial engineering, of helping companies survive, structuring a deal, and then getting them to the next stage. And that's enabled us to really build some good assets. And I talked about the capital light investment approach earlier. Where are we focused on? Well, we're focused on building value inflection point, helping the portfolio companies to go through various value inflection points, to realize ultimately exits or partial liquidity events, and to realize shareholder returns. However, it is not just about this set of companies. We're building a platform that we can build and use over and over again. There is a huge amount to be done in the spaces we're focused on, and the more of these businesses we do, the easier it is for us to engage with new ones. Now, there will be a trading update coming in the near future, so I won't talk too much about this, but I think in a way what happened last year with the venture capital markets and broadly in the global economy and the sectoral changes you've seen because of the war, because of the energy markets and so on and so forth, in many ways it has affected positively investors that are in the deep tech space. Crypto, a lot of digital fintech is suffering, but as the previous speaker noted, you know, where you have real fundamental societal needs, actually investors such as ourselves are in a good space. The energy crisis has made it quite evident that you need home insulation. The crisis in Ukraine, or the war in Ukraine, has shown that you need resilient telecom systems. The post-COVID crisis in oncology treatment has shown that you really need a transformation in how we treat cancer, and we're active in all of these areas. So in that sense, you know, I would say that last year was not a bad year for us, and you'll see the results. Now, importantly for us, last year we realized a partial liquidity event with one of our privately held companies. It was a profitable event. It was not a huge one, but it shows as a model what we're able to do to combine ongoing service fees with small sell-offs, partial sell-offs from some of our portfolio companies to pay our way through life so that we're not coming back to the market to fund the business, but to keep the platform going as an evergreen, and then of course realize upside returns when we have significant exits. We made further investments. We've added two new companies to the family. One is Ventiv, which is a heat pumps operation. The other is Recycling Technologies, which had an aborted IPO last year, and we acquired them out of administration. Ironically, it's a company that we exited a few years back, so we have history and knowledge and a lot of excitement. And we also did a small placement last year to enable us to complete certain investments that we had started. So here is the logo slide. Lots of logos, very nice. Every VC has logos. What does it mean? Well, it hides actual potential unicorns. It hides basket cases. But what's more important is what's underneath it. And that's why I've got this very simple slide for you. So in terms of how we do it, what's kind of underneath the under the hood, basically we've structured our process into several phases. And this is the platform. There is people, playbooks, hope you can still hear me. There's people, playbooks, and ways of doing business behind each of these stages. At the entry point, we are quite aggressive when we acquire a stake. We don't like to pay the list price. We look for special situations where we can make a difference. And as I said, we combine balance sheet with advice money to get inside the business and acquire a decent stake. Once we've done that, for those of you who have been around investing in early stage startups, you know the founders, you know the entrepreneurs. It's kind of pedal to the metal, go for the brick wall, doesn't matter the cash burn. And we say, no, hold on, slow down. Let's pause. Let's review the business plan. We use a specialist to rebuild the financial models of these businesses. We launch new go-to-market reviews to come up with a plan that we believe in, that our investors believe in, that can build the business in an efficient manner. Once we've done that, we implement a program using some of our resources, but also some of the suppliers and advisors we know to help the company go implement the plan. Sometimes it involves rebuilding a finance function. Other times it means really having a deep dive into their IP portfolio and optimizing their licensing program. Yet other times it means us bringing an executive to those businesses. But anyhow, this is anyway from 6 to 18 months program to get the companies to be investable at the next stage. And from here to here, we have a significant value crystallization. We come in quite low at this point. The companies are investable. They can be taken to the market broadly, whether it's EIS or family office. And we help them access that money with EMV Capital leading or co-leading an investment and ultimately having having an exit. And I hope this is a better way of showing where the portfolio is, because of course what we're trying to do is to push all these companies in this direction. Throughout this whole period, of course, we are making fees to pay for, not super fees, but we're making fees to pay for the infrastructure and ultimately looking for returns. PDS Biotechnology, I'll talk about in a second, but it's a I'll start from the right, unusually. It's an immuno-oncology company listed on NASDAQ. Current market cap is about 280 million. They have four phase two trials with some of the best names in the market. With one of the trials is with Merck's Keytruda, which is the leading or one of the leading drugs in the oncology space. National Cancer Institute, Mayo Clinic, and so on and so forth. Last year, they got a fast track authorization from FDA towards a phase three trial. They have not yet launched it. They're working towards that. And also a reverse licensing deal with the German Merck. While when the biotech bubble burst or when the markets collapsed, they were also affected. Over the last few months, they have been performing above their peers. Thus, the price has recovered. Our stake of 4.7% roughly translates. Today, it's just over 10 million pounds. At New Year, it was about 40 million pounds. There is some volatility. But it shows you what's possible in this space. Now, once upon a time, this was just a university spin-out that we, with our approach, identified, backed, staffed, and then we supported them through several key value inflection points, including their first placement to NASDAQ when we syndicated an anchor, and we have stuck around since then. We want to do, whether it's IPO or trade sale, we want to continue having such success stories throughout our portfolio. The fact that we are on the US capital markets, myself on the board of PDS, but also we know the various investment banks there, means that we have an active ecosystem in the US we're building so that we can help our portfolio access the very, very deep US markets. Now, going all the way to the left is Vortex Biosciences, which is also in the oncology space. In fact, we have a cluster of oncology companies. Another one not listed here is Glycotest, which is developing a liver cancer diagnostic platform, where we have Fosun Pharma, one of the world's largest pharma companies, co-invested in that. But here I want to focus on Vortex. Now, this is a UCLA spin-out, originally a US company. It is now a UK-led, UK-owned company with a facility in California and also here. We acquired a 30% stake through the process that I've just described at a very low valuation with one of our investment partners for a non-cash consideration, so it's sitting on our books for 300K in terms of value. We then implemented a multi-year fee-based process to take the company through an acceleration program, build partnerships, make placements of their product with KOLs, and I should probably tell you what they do. So essentially, it's a tool that can take blood from patients and isolate circulating tumor cells. Some of you might be invested or know of Ango PLC, so it's broadly in that space. We would say ours is better. But in terms of the commercialization strategy of it, we chose not to go for the obvious pickings in terms of we're going to do an LDT test for that approach. In fact, what we are building is a platform for the isolation of large volumes of CTCs, building a database around that, and working with pharma companies and big centers in helping them process the clinical trials that they have, but in particular helping with the post-treatment monitoring of patients where you need to make multiple interventions to see that there isn't a spread of the cancer and so on and so forth. So with this company, it is now a position for growth. We would expect a significant fair value increase once a fundraise is completed. And again, it shows what is possible. We attracted an excellent CEO, Paul Jones, who used to be the head of population genomics at Illumina. More importantly, before that, he set up Genomics England, which was quite critical in the Human Genome Project. And we're taking the same approach here because, believe it or not, there isn't a large database or library of CTCs. Actually, it is not a very well understood understood aspect of human biology. And for something completely different, which is Cubot. It's a robotics as a service company a spin-out from Imperial College. I've been involved in it almost from the outset when I led a small investment quite a few years ago. And we were sitting there and monitoring developments and very supportive of the business. But 2 years ago, we noticed several things. First of all, the platform that they have, you can see the robot here, really reached a critical stage in terms of autonomy, capability. What they do is they do underfloor insulation for homes, which is somewhat topical right now. Basically, you've got suspended floor homes, quite a few of those here in the UK, in Ireland, but turns out quite a bit of that in the northeast of the US as well, and similar applications in Europe. You put the robot underneath, and it, in an automated way, sprays insulation foam, which insulates the house. The market, of course, is coming in our direction because of the energy crisis, because of climate change, because of the push of climate change, but also because of the automation we're seeing in the construction industry. At that point, what we also saw is that, frankly, the previous management was perhaps a bit slow, perhaps a bit too focused on R&D, and we did a push with other investors to streamline management, to streamline the approach, do a bit of restructuring in the shareholding of the business, and push it to the next direction. In that process, we acquired, NetScientific acquired, we had quite a bit of managed money, as in third-party money, but we also acquired a close to 20% stake in the business, once again, at a good cost. We brought in external management, including a new CFO, who is now soon going to be the new CEO. But the proof is in the pudding, or the eating of the pudding. Revenues during our intervention period first doubled to 2.7 million. This year, the company is probably on track to do 4 million plus. Double-digit million pipeline just in the UK. Importantly, highly scalable way of growing by working with partners in this space, in the construction industry, in social housing authorities. We've launched an operation in France, and they've announced this on their website. We also had a highly confidential but announced visit to BASF's laboratories in Texas, where we're testing Cubot's approach for the US market. And the US market is a multiple of the European and UK market in this space. We were also able to execute certain secondaries in this company, on a profitable basis, which again goes towards our evergreen model. In terms of the future for this business, it may well be a trade sale, it may well be an IPO, but we have this approach of taking the companies, professionalizing management, the way they operate, bringing more investors at a higher valuation, and then taking them to exit. I can go on and on about the rest of the portfolio, but I stand between you and drinks, so I'll stop with that. And just as a summary, look, this is a transformed business from what we found a few years ago. Not only has the portfolio grown, but now there is a scalable, consistent approach for driving value through the portfolio. There is strong management commitment and focus. I hope I can communicate the passion we have towards the businesses we work in, and we work in really the high impact areas of society: healthcare, energy, industrials, and sustainability. There's a lot of things that we need to do this year, so please stay tuned, and please follow us on LinkedIn, and also you can sign up for our newsletter on the website. Stop with that.
Thank you. And Twitter, you have a good Twitter presence as well. That's where I harvested a lot of information about you when I was doing my research leading up to tonight. And congratulations for keeping going. But in terms of your voice, I'm just thinking about what about the search for a new chairman? Because when you lose your voice, it's good to have an understudy, even, you know, albeit an impartial one.
Yeah, thank you. That's what you're referring to is Q4, we announced several changes. One was Jonathan Robinson joining the board, the previous chair of the audit committee, Clive stepping down after helping us a lot, and John Clarkson, who helped as executive chairman in the last 3 years to get it to here. Look, last year was basically the end of the transition period when NetScientific acquired EMV Capital. We found a very difficult situation which required a lot of work and a lot of very specific work. That transition and turnaround period has completed, and the company is now moving to the next stage of its development. In terms of the search, it is ongoing. There's a lot of really exciting candidates that we're interviewing. There's really a lot of talent on the market, and we'll be making an announcement in due course.
It's just I feel you're a little bit like Atlas because the success of the company, from my research, is actually quite dependent on you because you're involved with some of the lead assets within the portfolio. You're the chief executive and, you know, you're losing your voice. So I'm just wondering whether the strengthening of the board is to enable you to outsource a bit of the administrative burden that you're currently carrying on your shoulders.
Well, I can whisper very loudly as well. But that is right. You know, we're looking to build a scalable platform, and a successful business cannot be dependent on any one person. I think we have moved beyond that quite some time ago. There is a lot of really strong talent in the business. I mentioned Ed joining us, general counsel and executive director last year. But there'll be a lot more of that to come in the coming months.
Anybody got questions before the voice completely? No. Right. Finally, the platform. The way you were describing it, I was trying to visualize it. So you described it as being evergreen. I was thinking of maybe the platform being a white label approach to portfolio selection and sort of asset management. So when we visualize the platform, what should I be thinking of in terms of images? Bar charts, perhaps?
I think there are others in other sectors that have really scaled this approach. And essentially what our platform says is, look, when we back a company that's in the construction industry or oncology, you're an expert in that. You're an expert in robotics. You're an expert in flywheels, let's say. But you cannot be an expert in everything. And because of all the deals that we have done and all the companies that we have worked with and the combined experience of our advisory group and co-executives, we can help you scale a sales function. We can help you set up the finance function. We can help you source the people that that you need to scale that business. Back to your metaphor of Atlas, you know, you don't need to feel like you've got a huge mountain on your shoulders. We're here to help you release the pressure.
Very good. And do go onto the company's Twitter, because I'm personally interested in Sage Tech Medical, which is, of course, launching a new device designed to reduce the amount of environmentally harmful greenhouse gas being released into the atmosphere by the medical sector. So I don't know, perhaps you should be speaking to the first presenter, though I'm quite sure he's not releasing anything harmful anywhere. But thank you very much, Dr. Iliev, Chief Executive of NetScientific. Thank you, and thank you for soldiering on.
Thank you.